Watson for their efforts. And so I mentioned voter education in a lot of things that I've done as your county party chair. And for those of you that don't know my background, I work at a facility in a small company across the road here in human resources. In human resources, we're doing a lot of hiring at our facility. And I'm not asking you to come over and apply, but I want to tell you a little bit of the story. So I've got a team of folks that we've been doing a lot of interviewing. And my message to that interview team is that it is their responsibility as an interviewer to make sure that they're getting information from the candidate. When the candidate comes to interview, they need to pressure test that person to make sure that they can do the job that they're interviewing for. And it is the responsibility of the interviewer to make sure that they can be getting the information they need to make the right decision. So my challenge to my interview team is the same challenge I would make to you as a voter. As a voter in Spartanburg County, we're going to county's going to provide the opportunity to see all the candidates. Tonight is one of those events. And it is your responsibility as a voter here in the great United States of America to get the information that you need to make an informed decision. And so my challenge stands tonight. Make sure that you're getting the information that you need to make the best decision you can in that ballot box. So with that, my challenge stands, and I hope that you take me up on that offer and make sure that you're educated when it comes to voting in June. I thank you again for being here, and we'll start the program off now with a prayer from Alexa Newman from CDC.
You're like me, you had a crazy day, a crazy week, but you are about to hear some great news, one of my favorite singers, Michael Lord. So just take a deep breath, let it out, and join me as I go before the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you so much that you brought us to this place at this time. I thank you for allowing us to be in a country where we can enjoy freedom, where we can freely call your name in your presence. God, I pray for this night, and I would ask you to share your spirit in this place. I pray for every candidate that will be speaking tonight that you would give he or she just clarity of speech that they would be able to communicate the message well. I pray, God, that this would be a night of intent, that we would represent, that they would represent themselves well. And God, as we listen to this speak, Father, give us an understanding exactly who it is that you want us to live for. I pray, Lord, that you would be pleased with all the events of tonight, and that you would enjoy your time with us. God, we love you. Thank you so much for your son Jesus, who paid that ultimate price, so that we can enjoy the true freedom of Christ. We love you and praise you.
Thank you.
Tom Crabtree, who is our moderator for tonight's event, has spent 38 years in broadcasting. He's a native Carolinian who has a life of 33-year Yale, two daughters that also live here in Spartanburg County. The two daughters went by Clemson, by the way. If y'all know how to get hired now, that's even tomorrow. Tom anchors, co-anchors, the 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, and then 11 o'clock weeknight newscast. And when I looked at Tom's bio today to prepare my statements, he had so many awards on that list that I couldn't name them all. But I think I would want to use the TV anchor of the year for 2006, which I think is quite the account. Help me welcome Tom Crabtree.
Folks, it's a real honor and a real pleasure to be with you this evening. I hope that the world's going to come in for a little while so that we can all just kind of sit down and dig in and not have to worry about anything else but this for our time together. Elections are something that are very, very important to me. My mother was a poll in North Carolina in the little community of St. Mary's where I grew up. And she'd get up very, very early and stay very, very late. Of course, those are the main things. And my grandfather's little country store was kind of the gathering spot where the men would come and talk politics and maybe have a little snort and just talk about the issues of the day. It was a gathering spot and a discussion spot. And I think anytime there is a good, healthy discussion of the issues that we have before us, that's a good thing. Because those issues are many, they're diverse, they're very serious, and they're very important. Candidates, I'm going to issue a challenge to all of you tonight. It is easy to criticize the other guy. In fact, those of us who are in positions of responsibility know that criticism is part of the job. But what is not so easy is a solution. Easy to criticize, but coming up with a solution, your solution, is what I think folks want to hear tonight. In some of these races, we have a lot of candidates. We have a lot of people to get to know over the next few weeks, if you haven't already. We need to know what their stands are. We need to know how they differentiate themselves from the other people. You need to get to know them. That's what this event is all about, and I salute all of you for being here. I salute all the candidates for taking time to be here as well. I wish the place was packed to the gills. It's not, but those of you who are here tonight will walk away with some really good information that perhaps you can share with others and make the selection the best informed vote you can. Thank you for being here. Things like that. It has never been easier to get information, so I would encourage you to do so, not just for not just the radio, not just the newspaper, but do your own research and reach your own conclusions. I tell folks, don't rely on us to tell you what is true and what isn't. You are the decider of what isn't true. So go to it. We're going to have a good night today. We're going to begin with our candidates on the Spartanburg County level. They are seated in the chairs here behind me. I'm going to introduce each of the candidates. You will have some questions. We have them ready for us yet. We're going to have the questions here in just a moment. Candidates, you will have 2 minutes to answer each question. Since your opponents in the county council race are not here, two are running opposed, but their opponents are not here. One has no opposition in the primary. I don't guess you're going to need to vote. So that'll work out okay. But we will limit you to 2 minutes. And where's our time? Where's our time? Where's our time? Yeah, these are for our county level candidates. And folks, I want to tell you, too, that one of the conditions I insisted on as we put together the plans for this debate was that the questions would not be mine. I don't want there to be any chance of anyone saying there would be bias. So the questions tonight are indeed your questions. question. And gentlemen, I'm just going to take it in order of your races, and I'm going to have to pull out my glasses. I just turned 60. Many of you have had much more monumental birthdays than that, but it's time for me to pull out the glasses. All right, first we're going to bring up Justin Bradley, who is running in Spartanburg County in District 2, Spartanburg County District 2. This is, again, for all candidates. What qualities do you possess or experiences have you had that you feel make you a better candidate? Thank you, Tom. Thank you for all for coming out.
Yeah, for me, I'm running for county council. And one of the most important issues that county council deals with is the budget. I'm a numbers guy. I like looking at the numbers guy. I like delving into the numbers and figuring out where we can save money. Looking for ways that we can look out for the taxpayer. My background is that I'm a attorney. I'm an in-house attorney with a mortgage company. And that experience allowed me to look at numerous regulations and how those were fit for people. And I helped my company navigate those regulations. So for me, I understand the burden that government can place on our businesses, can place on individuals. And so when it comes to the budget, our taxes are an enormous burden. You know, property taxes, we have to look at how that's affecting our residents, how that's affecting our businesses. So when you look at the budget, I also had an opportunity to work for the governor's office and work on budget issues. We have to prioritize the money. You know, unfortunately, government today, it's all on prevention. When we're looking at the budget, we're looking at just a small sliver compared to last year. Are we spending just a little bit more? Or are we spending just a little bit less? What we're not looking at is the entire budget. So we need to reform this budget process so that we're looking at the totality of the budget. And a lot of people, you know, go around on zero budget. That's a good starting point. Looking at the entire budget from zero and going up. But we also have to look at results. Prioritize that budget based on the results that we want to achieve. And make sure that we're spending based on those programs that are actually going to achieve the results we're looking for. So it's not just an incremental process. We have to absolutely look out for the taxpayer. As an attorney, I'm an advocate for my client, my company.
And I have to be an advocate for taxpayers. Thank you. Dale Colbert, Council District 5. Again, same question for you. What qualities do you possess or experiences have you had? You feel makes you better
man. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great day to be at Spartanburg County this evening. What do I think it takes to make a good quality for the county council? I have spent over 35 years owning and operating small businesses here in Spartanburg County. We need people that know how to look at numbers. We need people that know what it's like to have a burden of expenses. We need people that know how to cut expenses, keep things moving along expeditiously without rising the cost as much as we can. You have to have a service model. I have that. I started teaching Sunday school when I was 16 years old. I felt like it was something that I needed to do. It always made me feel good that I could serve and work with people and teach them things that I had to do. I had an opportunity back 15 years ago. I had an opportunity to be a chairman or board of the fire department. They came to me and asked me to join this and be a commissioner. And I told them I didn't know the first thing about the fire department. And I said, well, Mr. Coleman, do you know about running business? And that's what we need. Need somebody that knows how to look at spreadsheets and knows about expenses and how to get the best bang for the buck. That's what I do on Spartanburg County as a chairman of finance. I make sure that your tax dollars are spent wisely. We have been able, in the last 7 years, we have not raised taxes. We are running a tight ship. I think that qualifies me to be a part of this county council.
Right, thank you. Now, Nutt is running in County Council District 6. And folks, be sure to hold that mic.
Thank you, Tom. I know I always get tough questions and being unopposed this time around. Tom Murray said I can't talk bad about myself, so I'm going to try to make this as easy as possible. I don't know what makes me better qualified than myself, so I'll just take this opportunity to restate what Tom said a while ago, which is any time that I get a chance to answer questions. I got called by Jim a couple of weeks ago. He asked me if we'd come to him. He said I knew up that, there was a debate, and I didn't have any opposition. He offered me a spot and said, anytime anybody in the county has a question, they ought to be able to go somewhere and get the answer. So that's why I'm here tonight. I would like to give you any help. If I can, I'm sure we'll try. But I so much appreciate you coming out and the weather, the nice weather now, the bad weather later, the bad weather earlier, and get here and try to find out how to vote in this election. Because when we look at Washington, many other places, we just shake our heads and things are never going to change. They all start at the local level. People that you vote to go to Washington started out in the school board, county council, or somewhere else, and you're never going to change things on a national level and change things on a county level. So I appreciate you being here tonight. I appreciate you looking at branches. If you ever have any questions of me, or I'm sure any of the others, please contact us during the day and we'll try to get you an answer. I appreciate you coming.
Next question, candidates, of Mr. Bradley will go first. The question is, what do you see as urgent priorities for fiscal year 2014-15, and how would you propose to implement urgent priorities?
Thank you, Tom. You know, for me, when we're talking about a budget, priorities is what it's all about. You know, that's exactly how you budget in your house. That's exactly how businesses take care of the budget. So we have to look at the priorities. Yeah, as I said, we have to perform this process. So priorities are number one that we're looking at, and how do those tie in with the results we want to achieve? For me, when we're looking at the county level, priority number one is our public safety. We have to take care of public safety. Priority number two is our roads and infrastructure. That's one of the most important issues, and whether it's in the county and the state, the roads are in the worst condition I've seen. I know we have a lot of great officials that are working hard with us, but we have to do a better job taking care of our roads. One area we hear from constituents is the $25 road fee. People are not happy with the $25 road fee. They're saying, you already have this tax revenue that's coming in, I'm already paying enough in taxes. Why do you need more money from me? It's not going to happen overnight. We do need to work to phasing out that road fee, because we should be saying that roads and infrastructure is a priority in our budget to take care of without having more taxes out of your pocket. It should be coming out of taxes you're already paying. So I think roads and infrastructure is priority number two. And then we just look at everything else that comes out. In terms of comparing different issues, the roads and infrastructure, we only increased that just barely over the last 7 years. Since 2007, the parks spending has gone 160%. I think parks and recreation is great. My wife and daughter enjoy that going to the parks. But we also have to make sure that we're not spending more money on that, having new tax more to pay for our parks when our roads aren't up to where we need. So more spending on our roads is necessary.
All right, just ask Mike, Mr. Colbert, Mr. Cole, you would address urgent priorities for the next fiscal year. How would you propose to do
it? I agree with Justin. My primary concern is in council. Public safety is a number one issue. We have a good sheriff in Spartanburg County, a good sheriff's department, we have a good fire system, we have a good EMS system. We need to make sure that is always at the top of our list. We do have a financial lack of safety in our homes. Today is actually a national day for police memorial. And I actually got to do this on that same national action twice today, and I do replace. One of the things that I am concerned about, I think is top of our priority, and I think we're doing a good job at it, is economic development. Guys, we have things in Spartanburg County going on right now that just doesn't sound. We look back 2 months ago, we had $4.8 million, $1 billion investment in Spartanburg County. The largest single investment ever made in Spartanburg County. Or in the same stock market, I'm concerned. Then a few weeks later, we had BMW come up, made $1 billion, and that's what announcement. We're going to bring 800 more jobs. All right. Spartanburg County is in our jobs. Right now, Spartanburg County has the lowest unemployment rate that we've had in years. We have good jobs coming in Spartanburg County. Had an opportunity when I was in the council, had a reference with a world-class leader. He looked at it across the table, he said, no, he said, we need more jobs in Spartanburg, South Carolina. And he said, what we need is more, better paying jobs. Ladies and gentlemen, that is coming to Spartanburg County as we speak. We do have an issue. We have to have educated people and skilled employment ready to take these jobs. In Spartanburg County, our graduation list is not up to what it should be. We do not have the number of people with a higher education level than we need. We're working on it. There's a whole program right here now called the 3040 plan. By the year 2030, we're hoping to have 40% of the populace in Spartanburg County have an education level, a bachelor's degree or a associate's degree. This is what we need to do with jobs. The jobs are here. Our economic development team is bringing in good paying jobs. It's up to us as your leaders to support our education, support our good schools. We have here in Spartanburg County. We just need more work and the right time to do it.
First of all, I agree with both what Councilman Cole said and what Justin said as well. Roads are a major priority. It should be number two, at least, on our county priorities. And Councilman Cole was right about our economic development. I heard yesterday that over the last 4 years, we've added $22 million a week, 34 jobs a week for 4 years in Spartanburg County. Folks, the state would love to have those statistics. Spartanburg County does have those statistics, so we are really putting that where it needs to be. But above all these things, if we don't finally get a fix for our local government fund problem, all these things are going to be important. How many are familiar with the local government fund problem? About a third of the people. That is a local government fund is money that goes to the state through our sales tax. And the state takes that money and through all their state mandates, they give us a percentage of that money back. It's 4.5% of the last year's budget. By law, they can't change that. It can never go down. That's because the things that are tied to that are the clerk report, the detention center, public safety. There's so many things tied to that. The entire judicial system, if those things were to start being cut, it would be a problem. So they put in law that you cannot change it, except under certain circumstances where they pass a separate law specifically saying that they're changing it. Well, from 2009, they changed it every year. We've got about a third to a half of the money that we're supposed to be getting from the state. The state also mandates that we can't cut the services. So let's say that we get $5 million back from the state, and we're supposed to get $10 million. All the money is still spent for the clerk of court's office. It's already spent, $10 million gets spent, but only $5 million came from the state. That's where the other $5 million came from. You guys. So essentially, you pay twice in taxes for the exact same service. Why is it not a big deal? Because the state doesn't mind the county complaint. You know who they might complain? You guys. If I go to the state and say, man, y'all cutting our money, they would give you all kinds of money. You got all kinds of money going on. This money, but you're paying it twice. If we don't fix this, we've lost $20 million over the last 5 years.
Thank you.
That it?
By the way, yeah, great job.
Okay.
Thank you very much. By the way, Dan, I'm being kind of loose on this because we don't have that much time. Not deep in there, of course, I'll show you the other part. We've got 30, our bedroom, we've got Nutt left. Boy, he's going to shake you really out. So, okay. All right, guys, and Mr. Bradley, you come on up to the mic again. Here's your next question. Last year, during the budget process, a 5% tax increase was proposed and eventually voted down 4-3. Recently, some officials have suggested an increase in the gas tax. Do you favor increasing any taxes? And if so, what taxes would you propose and why are they necessary? I do not think we need any more taxes. Yeah, it's as simple as that. You're paying enough money on that. Then our elected officials can say that they're spending every single cent that you're sending perfectly. That's the time you start looking at that you need more money to meet our core obligations, but not more money for parks and recreation. We don't need to do across-the-board spending cuts because that only hurts the agencies that try to be more efficient in our sheriff's office and would actually reward the agencies who would not be as efficient. So I disagree with that approach. We don't do across-the-board spending cuts. We cut wisely. And in terms of the gas tax, I don't support it. Increase the gas tax. That's one area where I completely disagree. We do not need to become more dependent on what everyone who supports the gas tax is saying is a shrinking revenue source. The gas tax is going down because cars are becoming more efficient. Why do we want to become more dependent and rely on a shrinking revenue source for our state roads? We should become more dependent on stable revenue sources and actually reduce the burden on our taxpayers. So that's my approach, is we need to be reducing the tax burden, looking for ways that we can cut spending, and actually prioritize our spending for core services. Not going to increase taxes, so I think that's probably as far as we need to go.
Thank you. Mr. Cole, you favor increasing the main taxes. If so, what taxes would you propose, and why necessary?
I agree with Mr. Bradley. There's no reason to excuse to raise taxes. And I don't see that we ever need to. We're already paying the taxes. What we need is to be more efficient. I run a business. When our economy has fallen away in the last 6 years, if we run our government like that, we're going to cut some kind of our taxes because we're kind of shortfall. But in business, I've had to cut costs and lower expenses and make my product more efficient and at a better price to be competitive. That's the way government should be run. We are not, we do not need to raise taxes for anything. We need to make sure that our tax dollars that were already paid are spent efficiently and for the right things. And we need, yes, roads and bridges are a big priority here in our state. We need that. We need that to take off the But I'm afraid if we raise the oil and gas tax, it would eventually do like so many other things in the state of South Carolina. That would end up being spent on things other than what they were paid for. Thank you.
All right, Mr. Nutt, do you favor increasing any taxes? So what taxes would you propose and why necessary?
Well, I think there's always a time and place for a tax increase. Concession obviously is not one of those. Let me tell you, there may be some emergency situations the county comes up where we have to have more revenue involved. However, Spartanburg County has a problem. We created two problems several years ago. 2006, let's go back to 2005. 2005, a guy paid $1,000 for his general fund tax on his property. Had a reasonable expectation of paying for roads. Am I right? If you paid $1,000, a good portion of that was going to the road because you were paying for your roads in your county. When 2006, when we decided we didn't have any money for roads, we're still paying that $1,000. Where did that money go? We just kept spending. We spent all the way down to about 1/30th of what we started getting from the car tax. So in 2006, at our largest budget in history, we put on a road tax. Does that make any sense? What happened to the money that was going to roads in the general fund? It's not going to roads. They took the $250,000 and spent it somewhere else. So now we have a road fee. The road fee is working. We spend about $5.6 million on roads. But what we've done is we've taken $25 out of the tax base. So now if we needed it and we had to have it for our roads, we could go back and get it because you're already making it. We did the same thing with the hospitality tax. In some good years, several years ago, we decided we needed some money for $40 million in parks. Now, whether you love parks or hate parks, it doesn't make any difference. We're spending $40 million overall the next 20 years in parks. But now that we may have some problems, we're losing $20 million in local government fund, we've taken 2% out of the mix. So that's 2% less we can go back to the taxpayers and ask them. So now that we're in an emergency situation, and we're in some times where things are looking tough, we've taken out all that money, about $10.5 million out of this. That we could never replan. It's already being used on something we could have spent our own money on before. So I'm not in favor of raising taxes just for that purpose, because it has to be a special circumstance to raise taxes. If not, we're going to end up with money that you can't get back.
Yeah, that's a good question. And it's already been touched upon, you can elaborate now. What actions would you suggest to address the deficit in the local government fund disbursement?
So, you know, Roger gave a great explanation of the local government fund. You know, the biggest issue that I have is that I never heard of that as someone who's outside council until this year. You know, we needed a lot more awareness. Our taxpayers needed to know. And even now, when people are raising the issue much more prevalently, there still is a large portion that just don't know about the issue. So awareness is going to be a big one. You know, when you call your state representative, letting them know, it's also an issue in actually working with our delegation. You know, we have a delegation that has been working on this issue, and I appreciate the work that they've done on this. It's going to be working much more broadly with other counties to put pressure on their delegations. This is an issue of not just, you know, your tax dollars. That's an important aspect of it. We're paying tax dollars twice. But it's also an issue of our state representatives, our state senators, not following the law that they put in place. When they promised this money to the counties, and now we're not giving the money to the counties, that's a problem. When our counties are relying on this money, when we're drafting our budget and saying, we're going to pay for this, and not doing it, that hurts the budget process because we can't rely on this money. But the most important issue to me is, you know, they have to be accountable. They have to be making these promises. And I think the root issue is not just the money. The money is an issue. But the root issue is our entire structure of governance in South Carolina. We've got to get more control to the local communities, less control to the state, less control to the federal government, and allow our local communities, where you're closest to the people, actually allow them to govern much more efficiently. Thank you.
Mr. Clark, please propose how do we address the deficit of the local government fund this person?
I like something that Justin said a month ago. We need to have more control here on county level with our tax dollars than the people in Columbia. We're not isolated. We're here with you every day of the week. I don't have the opportunity to go off somewhere else and spend 2 or 3 days in Columbia. I'm right here. I'm in your neighborhood. I'm next door to you. You've got right here. This right here, and I'm not saying anything bad about any of our delegates. We have great knowledge in Spartanburg County, but it's not that way across the state. Apparently, some of the delegates forget about the people that are most important, the people that live back home, the people that are paying property taxes, the people that are paying us to make these decisions for them. I do believe in our rights to have more destiny over where our money goes. Right now, there's not a good answer. There's not a solution. I haven't heard a comment. It's from our county council. It's not doing enough about the local government. Guys, we have written letters. We have sent emails. We have been in Columbia. We've talked to associates in other counties. It is a situation where we don't have a way out of it. You know, it's been a problem that we can start getting out some of the things that this local government money is supposed to be going to. We can make cuts here and there. We can't do that. If we do, they will turn around next year and deduct it from our budgets. Guys, this is a problem that is going to have to be fixed in Columbia. You need to talk to your legislators and let them know how you feel about this. Our guys are good in Columbia, but we need to get the word to the others in Columbia that we cannot continue to go on this way.
Last thing you suggest to address the deficit of the local government on this one?
Well, believe me, we haven't answered this problem in our time. The initial answer would be, well, let's just start cutting services. Which part of the judicial system should we cut first? And see what problem we've got. The other problem is, even if we wanted to do that to prove a point, kind of make a state sit up and listen, is that when they write these special laws and say they're not giving us the money, they also write in there, oh, by the way, here's a list of things that you cannot use. And it's basically, there may be two or three things in our county that we cannot reduce, that we can reduce money from. So they set the level, and they give us half the amount of money that we're supposed to get, and they say, if you can't cut any services, we're not rolling out of that. Then here's the kicker. I found this out today when I was doing a little bit of research. When you look at the Spartanburg County Legislative Delegation, that's our guys here at home, they have their own office. And we fund that through the money that they give us from the state. They actually wrote a proviso in the Senate this year that says that if you, other things like if you reduce the clerk of court's office, you can reduce it, but the amount you reduce it by, you have to write a check. I'm not doing it. It says write a check to the state or to the spans. So if we cut out $500,000 from the clerk of court's office, we've got to write and state a check and give them the money, even if they didn't send us the money. But at the local delegation, if we were to cut the delegation office, not only do we have to pay that money to the state, we pay a 25% penalty. So they can cut our funding anytime they want to, but if we try to cut their own office, not only do we have to pay the money back immediately, we've got to write another check at 25% penalty. I think it's outrageous what the state is doing. I don't know how we're going to confront this, but Spartanburg County is going to confront it. And we're going to try to get as many counties as we can in the upstate and have a coalition. We have to go to local government. Greenville County is right now passing a tax. So you're paying three times for your services in Greenville. Because you've got a new tax, an old tax, and a state tax. Thank you very much.
And the microphone down here, y'all, please. Ladies and gentlemen, that is our questions for the candidates. And you are welcome, if you're comfortable there, you are welcome to stay there. Let's go back and sit in the audience. That's why I'm going to ask you to hang around. So again, go to your aspects and positions here. You may want to ask some questions individually when we wrap up. Again, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, now we're going to move on to the office of Spartanburg County Auditor. Your candidates of that seat are sitting right here behind me, Mr. John Lewis and Ms. Sharon West. And if you have a couple of questions for you here, you will be allowed rebuttal if you feel you wish to do so with these questions. The rebuttal time, by the way, will be 30 seconds. You'll have a couple of minutes, as did the candidates who just spoke. Let's see, we'll begin with Mr. Lewis, please. Come my stand here. And our first question, again submitted by the audience. How do you see the office of auditor affecting local government?
I'm glad you asked that question. Before I answer that question, I'd like to say happy anniversary to my wife today. Happy anniversary. She's here supporting me. Love you very much. Thank you for what you do, Mark. And now to answer that question.
Yes. How do you see the office of auditor affecting?
Well, the Office of Auditor is one of, I think, one of the most very important offices in the county. The Office of Auditor handles property taxes, handles village rates, and it just keeps things in line with what's going on with the tax payer. And it's a very important office. And what I plan to do in the office is be more efficient.
Sharon West, you have now on the risk is what do you see the office of, how do you see the office of auditor affecting the government?
Yeah, he's correct. Auditor Thomas is very important. We're a statutory office and we're charged with keeping complete.
complete list of all the property in Spartanburg County, and that list must contain the name of the owner, description of the property, location of the property, the value of the property. We also calculate millage rates for those properties, and we apply it against the value of those properties, and that gives you the amount of tax that you owe on your property. We also go in there and make any necessary correction to those records, should there be any corrections needed, and we make that correction to the record as well as the deed, which is the current record of the taxes. Once that's done, we pass that on to the treasurer, who gets to collect her taxes. We also, anyone out there who will admit to being 65, we also administer a homestead exemption, which is for people who are more than 65 years old. That gives them the first $50,000 of their home that they live in tax-free. We calculate that, we pay the application for the homestead, we also calculate the reimbursement that the state sends us back for that. We also take high mileage appeals on your vehicle. If you think that your vehicle will qualify for high mileage, or for some reason your vehicle is not valued as high as every other like-making model of that vehicle, you can bring us the documentation of that. We're allowed to change that. To begin with, though, just so everybody will know, every auditor in the state has to use the same values on the same make and model of vehicle to begin with. But you do have the right to appeal as long as you appeal before the last day that that tax is payable on time. Well, I guess my time is up, but that's basically the most important things that we do. I'm also available if you ever have a problem to call me, call my direct number, and I'll answer it for you. I'll do everything I can help you. Thank you.
All right,
thank you.
All right, Mr. Lewis, you are back up. Next question. What do you see as the priorities of the Office of Auditor?
What I see as the priorities of the Office of Auditor are two things: efficiency and transparency. As was mentioned before me, the most important thing in the office is maintaining adequate records. So we have to have an efficient system that will do that. We need to have an electronic records management system that will allow the office to be more efficient, that will allow the constituents to be able to search documents, necessary documents, and pay their taxes in an efficient, safe manner. Online.
Mr. West, the same question for you. What do you see as the priorities of the office of auditor?
The priorities of our office is to serve the taxpayers and to be available to the taxpayers. All of our records are public records. You can go in there and search anything that you need to know about any of your property taxes. There's very few things that we would redact in our records. Most of it is very available on the internet, on any of our websites. We also, one of the most important things we do is we gather information. Like right now, we're gathering information so that we can get your 2014 tax bills ready for you. So we're starting right now to clear all the 2013 files, which we do keep electronic files back to 96 on real estate and about that far on meeting. So anytime that you need something to look up from back, we do have that available as well. But we're starting to clear on all the old tax records off our current file and start putting things on there for 2014. We do have to have our books open on September 30th for your 2014 tax. You can begin paying them, and you have until January 15th to pay that without penalty. The next thing we'll do is we'll start getting budgets from these taxing entities, political subdivisions, municipalities, special purpose districts, any body we collect the tax for. We start gathering their budgets in July. We also start gathering the assessments from the county assessor's office, from the Department of Revenue, and also from the Department of Natural Resources. We compile all that into our computer system. We apply those assessments to those budgets, and that's how we calculate the millage rate. We do have different ratios for different classes of property. If you own your home and live in it, you get 4%. If you own it and live in it, you don't pay any general operating school levy on that. You also, if you're over 65, you get the homestead exemption. We're doing that right now. We'll keep doing it, and we check and double check and make sure that we get that right. And we'll have that on September 30th. Thank you.
All right, and your final question, Mr. Bush, would be our first. The question is, what qualities do you possess or experiences have you had that you feel may achieve a better day?
Well, the qualities that I possess are 20 years worth of mortgage and real estate finance experience. I've had an opportunity to manage budgets and originate millions of dollars over the years. I also served as the Polk County Board of Realtors Treasurer, where I had an opportunity to maintain a balanced budget and balance the books there. I will take that same approach and to do it in the office of audit.
Now, Ms. Webster, what qualities do you possess or experiences have you had that you feel may achieve a better county?
Now, Tom, that's embarrassing because I'm going to have to say, I've worked with the county for 43 and a half years, so I do have some experience. I came in tax collector office in 1970. 1972, I transferred to the treasurer's office. 1979, I was appointed Spartanburg County deputy treasurer and remained in that position until 2002 when I was elected county auditor. I'm very confident in my knowledge of Title 12, which is what we base most of our ad valorem tax practices on, as well as Title 6 and Title 56, which is the D&B statutes. I'm also very confident in my ability to answer a taxpayer's question. I don't think there's any question that I have not heard in my 43 years in ad valorem taxes. So anytime anybody comes to my office, I feel like I can take care of their problems efficiently and quickly as anyone else. Further, if it's something that I can't correct, I make sure that I take that person to the department or to the person who can help get that problem fixed. We have, during my tenure as county auditor, we have upgraded our computer system. We work with QS1, who works with 35 of the 46 counties in the state. We have developed several reports, my programmer and I, which saves time and manual work for the office. We're going to continue to work on that because that's something we love to do. Someone suggests something that we need to do, we get right to work trying to get it done. We have developed a refund system that's taken about all of the manual labor out of our refund process. We had a call day before yesterday, a man needed a refund on a vehicle that he had moved to West Virginia. We had that check in the mail today. So that's how quickly we get things turned around. We're going to continue to improve that as changes and improvements are made as the law changes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and candidates, those complete the questions. Ladies and gentlemen, your candidates for Spartanburg County Hall. Okay, we're about to change gears a little bit here, so folks, might want to get up and stretch a little bit, refresh yourselves. I'll call us back to order here in just a couple minutes. Thanks for your time as well, Mark. All right, folks, we are in the portion of our program, the meet and greet. In this section of the program, you're going to hear from the candidates for U.S. Senate, Superintendent of Education, and Lieutenant Governor. We're going to begin with the candidates for U.S. Senate. Candidates, if you would please come to the platform here, and going from the audience's left to right, I'm going to ask you to seat yourselves in alphabetical order. So please, candidates for U.S. Senate, please come to the podium.
Right.
have five candidates who are with us tonight. Benjamin Dunn, who is not with us here, and Mitch Brand is not with us tonight. We have five candidates who will hear from. Each of these candidates will please come to the microphone as I call your name and introduce yourselves, what you're all about, and you will have 3 minutes to do so. First, Dan Bowers. I'll let you know. You have a timekeeper on the front row here. And when he shows you the yellow sheet, you got 30 seconds. He shows you the red one. Finish your thought. Start shaking the red one.
Okay.
Really finish it off. All right. Well, but we will let you complete your sentence on time. Deb Bowers, man.
Y'all, I'm Deb Bowers, and I'm running for the United States Senate. I appreciate your vote on June 10th. The question we'll always ask is why? Why do you, at 62 years of age, why run the United States Senate? Shakespeare wrote, "There's a tide in the affairs of men, which taken to flood, leads on to fortune. Omitted, all the poetry of their lives is found in shadows and mysteries. There's no one here tonight who does not know the bond of trust between the governors and the government has been broken. Everyone else recognizes the lack of true character in Washington. And that doesn't regard every person. But it regards a lot of us. Unless we change the character of Washington, we're not going to change the country. There are two groups of people for whom I am running. The first groups I found in office, their blood flies up to us from the ground. They still have a vote in this republic. And what we found in Washington is that the principles that they enunciated 237 years ago are now scorned. They're not merely disregarded. It's as though we never have a law. There can be no question. If you have a conversation with George Washington today, he would cry out, "What are you doing with the land of the free and the home of the world?" If you talk to John Adams, he's a passionate man. And John Adams would cry out, "What are you doing with one nation under God? What are you doing?" Well, what are we doing? And y'all are the warriors in this battle because you came out. You came out tonight. You could have been other places. But you came out tonight because you want to make a difference. Well, there's another group for whom I am running. I had a wife who I've been married to 38 years. We have 3 sons, 2 daughters in law, 4 grandchildren. We actually have 5. The other one's on the way. He/she was supposed to be here Saturday. He/she hadn't shown up yet. So I'd like to get a call on the way home tonight. Come on to the hospital. We got 5 grandchildren. Now, those grandchildren, any of y'all have, they are precious. They're just precious. One of the things that will never happen on my watch is when one of my grandchildren would come to their grandfather and say, "Grandbaby, when you could have made a difference, why didn't you? Why didn't you make a difference?" The only way to make a difference is to get in the ring. I've got in the ring. Appreciate your vote on June 10th. Thank you.
It's good to be on in Spartanburg. I was down in Columbia, where it is quite painful. We just had a budget that passed. We only had 6 votes against. I just want to give a shout out to all of Spartanburg because Tom Corbin represents Northern Spartanburg County. I represent a good portion of Spartanburg County, and Shane Martin represents a good portion of Spartanburg County. That is half your no votes to the state budget that I've not said against the Spartanburg. Your elected officials in Columbia and Washington, D.C. are drunk with power. They are not listening. If your government grows, your liberty is strengthened. Who said that? Thomas Jefferson said that. If we get back to Thomas Jefferson's writings, we can get this country back. Government is dangerous. By its very nature, government grows and destroys liberty. Now let's think about that danger. Think about who sits in the Oval Office. Everybody in this room, when they grew up, they went to church. Your preacher talked about God bless America. We sang God bless America in our schools when we were kids, lots of us. Of course, they're throwing that out now. What did Barack Obama hear in his church? He heard God something else in America. It wasn't bless. And he's been trying to destroy this country ever since. We need a senator from South Carolina who's going to stand in the gap and take the fight for Barack Obama. Barack Obama is nothing more than a bully thug from Chicago. That's where he got his training. And he runs over people like that. Who's afraid of Obama? Assad's not afraid of Obama. Putin's not afraid of Obama. But John Boehner's scared to death of him. And if he's not, he's got Lindsey Graham, which is in John Kerry's ear, telling him to do what he needs to do. And let me tell you what's going to happen. This immigration bill is dangerous. Every one of our rights will be under assault. If we get this amnesty, you can forget the Republican Party. Lindsey Graham went to Barraza, and he said he was going to tell the bigots to shut up. And by bigots, he meant everybody that was against amnesty. They will come here, they will get citizenship, and they will outvote you, and the Democrat Party will triumph. This election is your last chance. Because I'll tell you what, you beat Lindsey Graham, and this amnesty bill is dead. Because people realize that if a giant with $7 million, probably going to have 10, can get beat by we the people in South Carolina, everybody's jobs are risk. Let me tell you something, the number one thing for a politician is protecting his re-election. Put some fear in them, because the greatest threat to national security is Washington, D.C.
Thank you. Employer engagement here in South Carolina is one of the most important elections of this cycle. Because really what we're engaging in here is, what is the Republican Party going to be about? On one hand, we have Senator Graham, which can only be described as a status quo, mainstream establishment Republican. Part of that crowd that would like to crush the Tea Party and go back and do it business as usual. On the other side, we have six candidates who said, that's not good enough. We have to fight what the Republican Party means. We know what the Democratic Party stands for. We're engaged in the struggle to find what the Republican Party will stand for in this nation. I spent the past year traveling around talking about what it is that I believe, and I believe so many of you believe, makes this nation great. That's the ideas and the principles of Christianity, capitalism, and the Constitution. And I believe in each and every area we can do better with the current representation that we have. Senator Graham is part of that group who's going to continue to vote for judicial activists like he did with Sotomayor and Kagan. Senator Graham is part of that group who's going to keep kicking the can down the road when it comes to fiscal responsibility, constantly raising the debt limit without any kind of structural reforms. Senator Graham has introduced a pro-life bill this year that he's pretty proud of. This bill will protect the baby once the baby becomes 20 weeks old. Folks, I'm here tonight to tell you that's not good enough. Human life begins at conception. The Republican Party must stand for something. We must find our heart and soul again. It must begin with the most basic principles. And I will say tonight those principles are the sanctity of human life and the sacredness of the institution of marriage. Those are the things I hold dear in my heart, and I believe that you do too. And those are, in fact, the two issues which will decide the future of this country. Now, I'm a conservative Republican in every sense of the word. I can check all the boxes. Less government, lower taxes, less regulation, returning power to the states. But let's not forget, my friends, it's the great moral issues It is the great moral absolutes that are going to determine God's blessing upon this nation, or God withdrawing his hand of blessing upon this nation. I wanted to go to Washington to be your voice, speak of the things that you value, the things that are big in your heart, the things that we must fight for, must win, to preserve the heritage that's been given to us, and that is our obligation to pass on to the next generation. So thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, U.S. Senate candidate Bill Potter. Ladies and gentlemen, there's one reason you need to vote for me. I have three children. One of them's a son. My son's in seventh grade, on eighth grade. He ran for student body treasurer, and he won. So don't give the chance to come back to your dad and say, Dad, you didn't win when I won. Please. Look, I'm fired up to be in the Upstate. Many know my story. My story started politically in the Upstate. I just got back in Afghanistan. I'd seen where our nation was headed in the summer 2008, fall 2008. The TARP bailouts, which our senior senator voted for both of them. The stimulus package Barack Obama drew up. And then February 27, 2009, I saw a tsunami come, the Tea Party movement. I introduced Jim DeVette on the State House steps in 2009, April 15, and I saw what happened. It was incredible. I saw the passion that came in, and it brought us a new house. All those folks that brought us Obamacare got washed away. And we had folks like the representatives we had been brought in, Trey Gowdy, people of that nature. It was incredible. I'm seeing that again. It's going to happen again. I decided to run because we're not done yet. We got the house back. We need to take the Senate back. And here's the bottom line. The reason I got this race, the reason a lot of us got this race, is this document, the Constitution of the United States. We are losing it. We were losing it back then, we are losing it now. You know, one of the candidates talked about the grandchildren, lots of children. The future is uncertain. We've got to fight for it to come back. What do I want to do as a U.S. Senator? One of the first things I will do is abolish the National Department of Education. Thank you. Now, I say that because there are departments that need to go. The Department of Labor, the EPA, a lot of things. Obamacare needs to go. It's completely unconstitutional. But just to make the point, I'm not just talking Constitution. The Constitution says nothing about education at the federal level. Nothing. Not one thing. Jimmy Carter brought it to us in the 1970s. That department has caused nothing but problems and soaked up money, soaked up time, soaked up resources. It needs to go away. And that's just a start. I want to go in there, and I'm not bigger than friends. I already said, two terms is it. And listen, I face Taliban bullets. I'm not going to back down the votes in the Senate. This is about your future. You know, I think people like Lindsey Graham went to Washington with good intentions, but after two decades, it's time for you to go home. Also, we have to fix immigration. None of these things you do. Here's the thing I would say is, it's for all of us. Please put us to your prayers. There's a sovereign God. I'm a born again Christian. I believe this. There's a sovereign God, and he can bring us victory in this. And imagine the victory it's going to be when we send someone to the runoff. And I've already gone to State House steps, and the people are there, we agree to back each other. But if we beat Lindsey Graham, it's going to be absolutely incredible. The shockwave across the country. Thank you so much, and God bless you.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, U.S. Senate. Nancy Mace.
Good evening, y'all. I know we're running for office, but we're not going to bite. Y'all can move up a little bit closer if you want to. My name is Nancy Mace. Some of y'all may know me as the first woman to graduate from the Citadel. And I did that in 1999 when I graduated magna cum laude from the School of Business. I've been married to my husband Curtis for a decade this year. We have two children. My son Miles is 7. He can drop a putt from 30 feet. I just drive the cart. He's better than me at all. And my daughter Ellie is 5. I'm a small business owner. In 2008, I started my own small business in technology and marketing consulting, working with small businesses, entrepreneurs, billion-dollar publicly traded entities, and startups as well. I have a master's degree from the University of Georgia. I sit on the Citadel School of Business Advisory Board today. I I was just selected to join the National Board of Directors for the Medal of Honor Bowl game. And I'm a former board member of Child Spring International, which is a faith-based nonprofit that provides life-saving medical treatment to young children. So I've always tried to be involved in my community over the years as well. What I see happening in Washington, D.C. today is I see a federal government that is stuck in the industrial age. They do not understand the economy of today or the problems and challenges that are facing small business owners and individual taxpayers all across the country. They do not get it. What I see today is an establishment culture in D.C. that is completely out of touch. They're out of control. And they think that you are here to serve them. And I'm here to say to you tonight, no, we are not. When I see what's happening in Washington, D.C., I ask myself, can we trust this government? Can we trust this administration? Can we trust your politicians who are up there today? Do you trust this government with your tax dollars? I don't. Do you trust this government with your health care? What about your personal phone and email records? Because if you do, I'm not your guy. I don't trust those folks in D.C. When I decided to run for office, I saw that for 60 years, this seat has been held by two people. We have conservatives in Washington who are standing up against the Constitution. They're standing up against reckless spending. They're standing up against tax increases. They're standing up against some of the most liberal Supreme Court justices this nation has ever seen. And almost always, Senator Graham is on the other side. When I am South Carolina's next U.S. Senator, I am not going to raise your taxes by $620 billion like he did. I'm not going to send foreign aid to our enemies, and I'm not going to fight and get my hands on your personal phone, email, and tax records. The only way we're going to change Washington is to change the people we send there. My name is Nancy Mace. My website is nancymace.org, and I need your help. Please vote for me on June 10th. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, your candidates for U.S. Senate. Thank you all. Thank you to the audience. I'm sure folks will talk to each other after, so please hang around if you can. Up next, we'll have our candidates for South Carolina Lieutenant Governor.
He said, I'm tired of hearing. Well, I'm tired of hearing, but there's a new spirit brewing out there, and people are starting to recognize that we are moving up fast. And one reason I'm running for this office, which I did not know was going to open up when Glenn McConnell decided to become the president of college charge, is because I see the next 4 years as critical to the future of this state. There are things that we can do now. If we do them right in the next 4 years, we can leave the competition behind. Everybody here has been to the beach where you try to catch a big wave. You see it coming, and you try to catch that wave. If you hit it just right, you ride that thing on in the shore. end up on the same line on the bed. If you miss it, you watch it go, you watch your friends go up to the show, and you wait for the next wave, and you wait, and you wait, and you wait. And it might never come, and you never catch up with it. That's what's gonna happen to us if we don't get everything. If you read closely in the newspapers, you see that the economic forecasters are saying that the economic explosion is going to happen in the Southeast and will be centered in South Carolina. I did a little computation on the web there. BMW, for example, now produces 300,000 automobiles a year. That is 34 per hour. When they expand with this $1 billion expansion, and we will have more such things in our state, it will be 51 vehicles per hour. It will produce more vehicles in South Carolina, in Greer, than in any of its plants in the world. Charleston, South Carolina today is the number one tourist destination in the world. Our port produces $43 billion worth of economic impact, taking $63 billion worth of things in and out. I'm tired of hearing about how South Carolina can't do it. All we have to do is have the will to change a few things. We got to be sure that our ethics are above question. People got to have confidence in our government. If they're worried about corruption, we can't prosper. We got to be sure that old people are safe and secure. Nikki Haley is taking care of the big business, we got to take care of the small business. And finally, we got to watch out for the federal government, because they will encroach on us and they'll strangle us. I had the honor of being Ronald Reagan's first prosecutor appointed in the country in 1981. And we had the honor in this state of putting together the team of attorneys general that brought the Obamacare lawsuit that almost brought them to their knees, but it saved us from spending $1 billion over starting 3 years over the next six. We got to fight the federal government. I'm the man who has had the experience getting things done, and experience matters. I want to help us. I'm proud of us, and I appreciate your vote. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the candidate for Lieutenant Governor Ray Moore.
My name is Ray Moore, and I'm running for Lieutenant Governor in the Republican primary. I think I'm in the right meeting for that. I'm 70 years old and running for the first time, so you can't accuse me of being politically ambitious at 70 years old. I've been traveling the state with Henry and Pat McKinney and Mike Campbell, and they know them very well, and Mike Campbell. I don't want to like them too much before June 10th. I'm running primarily, first let me tell you a bit about myself. I'm a 1965 graduate of Citadel in political science. Been married 45 years, have a wife and four children, four adult children, seven grandchildren. And also, I'm a 30-year veteran of the Army Reserve, retired as a lieutenant colonel, and served in World War I, where I earned the Bronze Star. Now, when Lynn McConnell announced that he was not going to run for re-election, that's when I got interested in this race, primarily for a reason of elevating the issue of school choice and the need to grow private or Christian or home education. I've had a ministry for 15 years prior to grow home education, Christian schooling, as opposed to public school, which I think right now has gotten into a terrible condition and really do a lot to harm our children. We need competition, we need school choice, we need to consider alternatives to state-run public education. But the Lieutenant Governor's office has nothing really to do with that particular job, even though all the Lieutenant Governors talk about other things that they're going to do, like job development, economic development. So that would be my project. Let me take a minute and talk about the constitutional duties of the Lieutenant Governor and what I would do in those cases. The primary duties are to preside over the state senate and to manage the Office on Aging and Disabilities. With regard to the state senate, we have a bill Chumley bill on nullification. It went to the state senate where the effort was led by Senator Tom Davis. And Lieutenant Governor ruled it not germane, ruled out of order, not really voted on or debated much in the state senate. I would not have done that. I would have allowed the Chumley bill to go forward and be voted on and perhaps become law. Concerning me, I'm a member and co-founder of the South Carolina Sound Money Committee, which is an effort to monetize gold and silver coin as an alternative to the dollar, which you have to be living in a cave not to know that the dollar is in serious jeopardy. We're facing financial emergency. So I would allow that bill also to go to the Judiciary Committee rather than the Finance Committee, where I think it would have gotten a better hearing. So those are the things that the Lieutenant Governor can do as an office of presiding over the Senate. And finally, the Office of Aging and Disability. I'm a 40-year congregational minister, or army chaplain, or director of Christian ministry. And I believe I have unique background and skills that would allow me to engage the local churches and pastors in a more meaningful way to assist our growing aging population. This is one thing Lieutenant Governor Trump did in a wonderful fashion. He had ran that office very well, and in checking around the heads of senior groups, they were very satisfied with what he did. And I would carry on that tradition. And so that would be what I would do here in the office. VoteRayMoore.com. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for the next choice. All right, gentlemen, welcome to see joining us. Thank you so much. If our candidates for Superintendent of Education would now make their way to the podium. Ladies and gentlemen, as they do so, I want to recognize members of our legislative delegation who are here. They're not part of this event tonight in terms of making a presentation, but they are here for you to speak with if you would like to. Our state lawmakers would just wave their hands as I mention their names so folks will know where you are. Bill Chumley. Mr. Chumley is here tonight. Okay, thank you. Mike Carson is here. Gay Fulton is here. Another candidate is here. Also, Don Hicks Wood. So those candidates are available if you wish to speak with them as well. Do we have some who are who come in later? Okay, well we're about to start that portion of the program. Thank you.
All right, so alphabetical.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, again, these are your candidates for Superintendent of Education. Candidate, you'll have 3 minutes to tell us what you're all about. We have a timekeeper on the front row. He'll show you a yellow card. You have 30 seconds of that. A red card. It's time to wrap it up. Ladies and gentlemen, up here first for you will be Sally Atwood. And Sally Atwood.
Hi, I am Sally Atwood, and I'm the Superintendent of Education. I want to share with you who I am, why I'm here, and if you vote for me, how we can make education a priority. I've just come from the classroom 3 months ago. I was a special needs teacher. And no, I was not for Common Core because I knew that one set of standards does not fit all students. I grew up in Union, South Carolina. My mother worked for the Union County Schools for 49 years, and she said, be a teacher. I went to Winthrop University and made it elementary and special ed. I taught along here, went to Winthrop at night, and got my master's. I married the love of my life, Lee Atwood, and we went to Washington, D.C., where I worked in the United States Department of Education and special ed programs. But after 2 years, I put it aside to work for that great conservative cause for re-election of Ronald Reagan. You probably remember my husband's story. He, you know, orchestrated the presidency for George Bush, became RNC chairman. Let me tell you mine. On March 5th, 2008, 1990, I got a call that nobody ever wants to get. I got a call to come to the hospital. Lee was there, I thought he had fallen, but he was diagnosed with a malignant brain tumor. And they said it could possibly, though he died the next year, and I raised as a single parent, I have three little girls. My youngest, Sally G, was 11 months old, my middle, 5 years, and my oldest was 10 years old. And ladies and gentlemen, I learned the value of faith, family, and friends. I had the privilege of working for President George W. Bush running the presidential committee. I shared with this because it is very much like the State Board of Education. But these members were chosen from all over the country, and I had to bring consensus so they could make recommendations to the president. Then I had the privilege of working with that in the Congress of the United States, in the House of Representatives, of course, on the Republican side, in the Committee on Education and Workforce. I came back to South Carolina, though it was an honor to teach, and coming back to South Carolina, teaching young women had the greatest impact on the life of a child, except for the parent. I was teaching when I ran the Medicaid's Education Reform Initiatives. Ladies and gentlemen, I thought they were dying in. She called for four things, and one of the most important was the reading coaches, because I knew that if a child was not reading by third grade, difficulty with our education system. Also, her plan calls for more education options for South Carolina families. Charter schools, private schools, homeschooling, I'm all for it. I also want to share with you my vision that I organized by the ABCs. A, accountability. We know that the teacher is held accountable for what's learned and not learned in the classroom every day. I want to have more accountability at the local school levels and at the State Department of Education to get more monies back down to the classroom. $250 is what we got for materials fee for a year, and I had to bargain for paper.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, the Superintendent of Education, Nita Childs.
My name is Nita Childs. I'm a teacher, mentor, coach, mother, and devoted military wife. My husband is in the United States Army Reserve, a native of South Carolina, and a strong conservative. Proud to have the endorsements of people like Dr. Lee Zace, Senator Kevin Bryant, Representative Mary Banfield, Representative Chris Crawford, and here recently, President Ralph Norman, Senator Tom Davis, the South Carolina Club for Growth, and just today, Mr. Josh Campbell. So I'm proud to have those behind me who are supportive of my candidacy. I started out in the classroom as a teacher. I started out with my education in Duke University where I received my master's degree, my license to teach, and my master's in public policy. I started out in the classroom as a sixth grade social studies teacher. I left the classroom to join the work of the Mark Sanford staff as an education policy advisor. I served in the private sector. I continued my public sector, my public sector service as a member of the Education Oversight Committee, where I stood strong with parents, with students, and with our educators, voting against the adoption of the Common Core State Standards. I moved back to the public sector, where I served with General Mid-States as a deputy state superintendent of education. I believe we need to make sure that each child is prepared for work, for college, and for citizenship. And as your Mid-States superintendent of education, I pledge five things to you. One, I will make sure that we bring real accountability to our classrooms, because schools should be accountable to children, and the South Carolina Department of Education should be accountable to taxpayers. Two, I pledge to fight to individualize education. The reason I think this is important is because we all know that parents know best how and where children should be educated. We need to support an array of educational options. So whether it's charter school or traditional schools, homeschooling, private school, apprenticeship programs, we need to empower parents with real educational choices, and money should follow the child to the learning environment their parents choose. The first thing I pledge to you is that I will fight to protect the power to liberate to our state by eliminating federal overreach. Common Core got our attention, but Common Core is not the first instance where the federal government sitting in Washington, D.C. was trying to reach down to our classroom in South Carolina. We need to push back on federal overreach in all of its forms. Second, the one thing I question you is to attract the very best teachers for our students. Because this is just common sense. We know that every child deserves high quality instruction every day in each school year. We need the very best teachers leading our classrooms. Then finally, I pledge to improve opportunity and community involvement, because we know that while we have to hold the adults in our system accountable, some of the challenges our schools face, they're simply not going to be able to address on their own. My name is Nika Childs. I ask for your vote on June 10th. Please tell others what I'm trying to accomplish. I ask that you consider making an investment in my campaign. And just remember, a vote for Nika Childs is a vote for our children.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Superintendent of Education, Don Jordan.
Good evening. I'm Don Jordan. I'm a faculty member at the University of South Carolina, Columbia. I'm a mathematician. I love my job. I really don't want to leave. I'm going to tell you why. I'm going to leave in just a minute. But first, I want to make sure I don't make a promise. Because I did this to my wife. I told her casually that I was going to ride her around the block in a rickshaw on the 25th wedding anniversary. Well, it came. She held me to it. So I found some students that I knew in India, and they went to Casablanca. They found the rickshaw, we shipped to New York, stayed there a while, got it customs in Charleston, and I got it refurbished and got it ready for Thanksgiving to ride my wife around the block. So I made that promise and I kept it. So I'm not going to make y'all any promises. I don't want to have to go through that again. But I had 100 students in a math class. I asked them how many were in debt. 60 raised their hand. I found out between $30,000 and $100,000, and they're just juniors. I can't face my students. It's not fair. It's not the thing to do. Nobody is talking about tuition increases. We have to stop tuition increases. So what are we getting our students ready for? Henry Matthews said this is a great state, and it is. And we got some of the best schools in the country. I can name you a person right here at Riverside, which is Upstate, named John Corbin, that won the International Science Fair. I was the science fair director at USC. He competed against the magnet schools in New York, in California, Virginia, and he won everything in botany worldwide. That's repeated in my life many other times. If I was in Hilton Head, I talked about Stacey Carter. I was in Lexington, I talked about Ben Park, and so on. So we have some of the best schools in the state, and we have some of the best students. They compete. There's no doubt. Problem is, we have a diverse society. Just as my heart goes out to work with the gifted, I also work with the underprivileged. And that's where I have another problem. Because I do outreach programs all over the state of South Carolina, and I've done it for decades. And I go into these rural areas, and I try to promote students to get into college. I look at them, I'm looking at them in the face, and I'm saying, I'm getting you ready for college. But they can't work their way to college like I did. I was fortunate. I had a job with a slum construction company. I think they're based out of Greenville. I was able to work my way through college, 5 summers with them. I came out debt free. If it was 2014, I couldn't go to college, nor will we be able to send anybody from middle school class down to college if we don't stop tuition increases. That's not my only aim. I have to look at my faith. I'm Don Jordan, just like the river. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, candidate for Superintendent of Education, Molly Spearman.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. I know you've heard a lot tonight. I'm running for Superintendent of Education. I'm well prepared for the job. I taught school for 18 years, served as a principal, worked 4 terms elected to the State House, served on Education Committee, Ways and Means, went to the Department of Education, worked, served as chief of staff there, worked with all the principals and superintendents in the state for the last 10 years. So, I'm prepared, I'm ready, I'm willing, and I'm just like you. My dream is for my children and grandchildren to be a little better than you are. And I'm afraid now that with the changes of jobs in our country, we're not able, we're not really preparing our graduates for the jobs. jobs that are available. We've got to do this and change this fast. We've got to get Washington out of the classroom. It's a South Carolina and Spartanburg local issue. That's what we're doing. We've got to individualize. We've got to train our students to let them know about the great careers that are available. We've got to support our teachers. We've got to have a great principal in every school. That's how you keep good teachers. But most of all, we've got to train for our kids and know that South Carolina is the place that we can do great things. And I'm really tired of all the negativity around education in our state. I want it to be positive. And I want to be a positive ambassador for all the teachers, principals, and students in this state. And I ask you to vote. I leave you with a little story. Like all parents, we want our kids to be great, and sometimes maybe even be like us. So this lady, a doctor, she was hoping that her little girl would grow up and be a doctor like she was, and the little girl showed no interest. Until one day, mom noticed in the back seat, the little girl had actually picked up the stethoscope and had it on her ear. So she said, "Let me turn down the radio and see what she's saying." The little girl goes, "Welcome to the novice, can I help you?" They have nothing wrong with it, not from scratch. You'll probably own a franchise. But we got to dream for our kids. And I want to be able to set that vision. But I promise you, if I'm elected, everybody will be at the table. Teachers will be at the table, principals, parents, the educational community, business leaders in the state. And together, we will look for the solutions that will improve education in our state and move our state student achievement forward. I would appreciate the vote of Molly Spearman, like the Spearman Gun, and be on the ballot probably the last name of eight people. We've got some great candidates to choose from. I hope we're giving you a chance to serve as United States Superintendent of Education. Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen, and candidates for Superintendent of Education. Many of our candidates you've heard from tonight and others who were not part of the program but are here in attendance this evening are still around. If you'd like to go and talk with them individually, I'm sure they'd be more than happy to hear your concerns, answer your questions, and give you some additional information. We want to say thank you to Settles Greenhouse for your flowers that are at the podium this evening, and a special thanks to the organization committee. Folks, it's been my honor to be with you. I have a story about what Jim said, but you can watch that. Take care, God.